gave them heaven and rent.
Gives life to the world. So they said to him, Sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May I remind you for the days it's available to hear confessions. 400 years before Moses was born, his ancestor Jacob took his whole family to Egypt as requested his son Joseph. The reason was to escape from a situation of famine back in the homeland. In these 400 years, Israel became so large that the Egyptian king started being extremely worried that one day the Israelites would turn against their cause. So he started oppressing them. He forced them into slavery. Freedom was taken away. Their male children were killed to avoid them becoming an even more powerful nation. They were forced to work under very painful circumstances. Then God sent Moses. God saved his people through Moses. So because of him, they were not slaves anymore. They left Egypt and they started heading towards the promised land. And yet something strange happened. They were not very happy with this whole idea of being saved. They started complaining against Moses. That was even worse. They wanted to go back to Egypt. They wanted to go back to the place where they suffered so much, the place where they were slaves. Instead of trusting God to provide for their needs, they began to resent Moses and complain, why he took us out from Egypt. Were very ungrateful or blind. Yes, the way to the promised land was a difficult one, but they were free and they were so soon arrived to a place which was so much better than what they had left behind. But it didn't matter to them. They had been slaves, they were free, and yet they wanted to be slaves again. St. Paul encountered a much more situation that problem that he addresses in today's reading. What brought a great pain to his heart was the fact that he saw many Christians, people who had been redeemed and freed by the blood of Jesus, by baptism, and yet they were turning back to the former world of life, to the situation slavery. For them, this newfound grace didn't matter anymore. They would rather go back to the former way of life, a life of sin, a life of slavery to sin. Jesus Christ, in whom they had believed, became something of the past. Sin thus became their present, became their master. Their understanding became darkened. Jesus Christ was no longer felt as a living influence in their lives. They became slaves of sin again, as if they had been before. As if the baptism they had received as a belonging to the church or something that never existed. Maybe it's sad to say, but this happens a lot in the life of many Christians who have been made free by Jesus Christ, and yet they want to be slaves of sin again. We may become so used to sin, to living in sin, that we see it as something normal, and even something that we may desire. When people first become aware of their conscience, that they 40 to 100, and they regard it at first with great. But then the conscience is like, goes to sleep, doesn't speak anymore. And then he was gone, starts seeing sin as not as bad as it is. And begins to raise that condition. And then following Christ, stops having a way of being. He becomes like a shell. This Christian may continue to have an exterior appearance of being a disciple of Jesus, but the person is actually not under Christ anymore, but under the influence of sin, mastered by sin, a slave of his or her own sinful tendencies. The Gospel tells us that people were looking for Jesus, but they were only concerned for their bodily needs. They were so enthusiastic about the multiplying of the food, bread and wine, which for us Sunday, that they wanted to make Jesus a king. They were blind. They were blind to the spiritual aspect of the miracle. They were blind to the message that Jesus wanted to teach them through this wonderful miracle. And Jesus tells them somehow, do not be blind. See beyond what you are seeing. And do not work for the food that cannot last, but work for food that endures to eternal life, the kind of food that the Son of Man is offering to you. The Lord required the crowds from us a conversion, a change of mind, to stop being a slave, to start becoming free by welcoming Christ. The Lord wishes to give himself to us, to free us, but we have to accept that, not just accepting them to be and accepting the demands that really imply, which is a conversion, a change of heart, a change of life. Many people approach Mass on Sunday for joyous communion, and you say, well, it's a good thing, but is it for everyone? How many receive communion today or on Sunday or go to Mass knowing that they shouldn't? Because they are in a state of mortal sin, in a state of slavery to sin, sins that have not been repented. And yet, because of whatever reason, still go to communion. I don't care, or I am afraid of what my friends would think or say if I stay in the pew. And sometimes we may be afraid of what people think, or we are not afraid of offending God. It doesn't make any sense. If we know that we are not living the grace of God, then we shouldn't go to communion. It would be worse. We should go first to confession. Confess our sins to the priest. With the sacrament of confession, we say to the Lord, Lord, give me your forgiveness. And then we repent and truly convinced that forgiveness is given to us. The bread from heaven that Jesus offers us is the Eucharist. And the proper way to receive this blessing is to open ourselves to God's love and forgiveness given to us in the person of Christ, especially through confession. In the Gospel today, the crowds of people whom Jesus fed in the wilderness came looking for him. They wanted more bread. Jesus made the opportunity to point them towards something greater. Do not work for food that cannot last, but work for food that endures to eternal life. Our Lord wants us to see beyond the needs that we have, food, drink, sleep, and hours and clothes, but we have deeper needs. And He is the only one able to fulfill them. There was in the 60s and 70s, 50s and 60s, an actress in Hollywood actress called Dolores Hart. She had a very promising career. She had several movies with Elvis Presley, And yet, when she was 24, she decided to become a sister from the Order of St. Benedict. A vocation she has answered until now. She's close to 80 years old. And she says this: many people do not understand the difference between a vocation and their own idea about something. The vocation is a call, one that you do not necessarily want. The only thing I ever wanted to be was an actress, but I was called by God. So for her, it was in this way that Jesus wanted her to look not for the food that perishes, but food that endures to eternal life. How much time we invest on things we think we need or want to achieve before we die, the goals we set for ourselves, for our families, our children, often ignoring that this life is just a preparation for the next, and that our lives would be a complete failure, no matter how much we have achieved, if we have failed to save our souls, we failed to bring them to eternal life. Jesus said that he came so that we may have life. Don't we have life already? Yes. But life is not true life without him. Life is not true life away from him. Without him, life is something destined to perish. With him, life is something destined to eternity. He is the way to eternal life. And those who follow him, follow his way, will live forever. Only he can make such a promise. And why? Because he is God himself.
Service in Paris. We pray to the Lord. Oh, Lord, hear our prayer. Answer us in
Lord. We pray to the Lord.